Hi guys, welcome to DevOps School.
Okay, so let's start with the topics today. So we'll be going to talk about two topics today, which is module 6 and module 7. Module 6, which is talking about monitoring. Module 7, which will be talking about
I opened another call. I mean the training call. So let me join in that.
So module 7 will be talking about data production. This is the one. So I just wanted to finish one topic pretty fast compared to other topic, which will be time consuming because there are a lot of things to be covered from the monitoring perspective. So let me talk from the data protection perspective. Something called data continuity and data production, Microsoft by default in the production environment take care of the data protection aspect internally. Okay, so how do they protect the data? They ensure that nobody else will be able to fetch the data unless they have the proper level of access to fetch the data from the respective endpoints. Endpoint could be your storage. Endpoint could be your VM. If the person will not have the respective access of the storage with either access key or the URL, endpoint, they will not be able to access it. And somebody try to intrude the system, indirectly. So the data at the rest will be kept into an encrypted manner. And unless you have a proper key, the data will not be sent to the target or the requester, in an unencrypted manner. As a result, the data will be always in the encrypted manner unless you have a proper valid key. So some level of data protection is already inbuilt, but certain level of data protection has to be done by yourself. So in module 7, we'll be going to talk about those production mechanisms. One of them is data replication. So here you actually have to choose, what level of replication you want to use. I hope you've been aware of one of the major aspect of data storage somewhere in the cloud is via storage account. And we have different level of replication for the storage account. That's what we'll be going to discuss here quickly. Then we have something called file and folder backups. We can take the files and folder backup using a file sync service. And we can also take the backup for the virtual machine by using something called backup capabilities offered by Azure using something called Recovery Service Vault. So we'll see all those aspects. So first topic will be theoretical only because you've already been to that particular topic earlier. So if I just look for the data replication, you got different replication option available for the storage account as LRS, ZRS, geo redundant, and read access geo redundant. And you can actually compare different type of replication strategy for the storage account. So if you remember that when you create a storage account, then using replication, it ensures something called durability and high availability. So replicating the data across different regions or within the same region, but across different data center, or within the same data center in the same region, but across different storage devices can be possible by using different type of replication strategies. So if you use LRS, I told you that in the LRS, what happens in the single data center across multiple storage devices, three copies of the data will be maintained or your storage account will be maintained. Okay. And if you look for something called zone redundant. So basically the same three copies will be actually splitted across different data center of the same region. And in order to see this chart, you can actually understand this mechanism. Quickly, just to review, we have discussed that by creating a diagram. I have given you diagrams for LRS, ZRS, and GRS along with RAGS in your drive. Okay, they will actually make your concept much more clear. So this is similar to here. You can look for LRS, also known as local redundant storage. Maintain three copies of your data. Data will be replicated three times within a single data center facility under a single region. So it maintains three copies of the data. Out of them, one will be active, other two will be passive. Okay. And it is useful for such kind of scenarios wherein one, the data can be replicated into a single region. and the other region where you want to replicate the data may be falling under that particular region where the regional governance requirements have been there for data auditing. So banks will not actually refer this particular GRS, I would say, global, because in the globally redundant service, you know, it maintains three copies, one in the primary site, one in the secondary site. But it will not let us choose the secondary site. Even if we pay too much money to Microsoft, Microsoft will choose the optimal path from your source to the destination data center across different regions to maintain six copies across different regions. So if you have a regional governance issues, you know, the some regions like China, some regions like Germany, wherein Azure has to follow some additional compliance because the, that particular country specific government doesn't allow, you know, the data to, you know, frequently in and out without being audited, no matter what kind of data it is. So the single piece of data, what has been actually going within the data center of Germany or China or outside Germany or China, they need to be audited. So that's what their governance law says. And as a result, like, you know, that if you actually been deploying some region somewhere in the Western Europe and you get to know, like, you know, okay, that in the Western Europe, you got something called some region, and that region has got, you know, it's a replica site as Germany. So in that case, governance issue may come. LRS is low cost option because it only maintains three copies. Unlike ZRS, ZRS maintains same three copies, but across three facilities or two or three facilities, but in the same region. Okay. So in order to have across geographical region also, we call it as geo zone redundant storage. That's a combination of geographical and zone redundant both. So that will suffice the OR part here, this one. So zone level redundant, replicate your data across three storage in the cluster in the single region. Each storage cluster is physically separated from other, that aside its own availability zone. Availability zone, as I said, like, it's a parallel data center facility available in a particular region. And you can actually see from the Azure region map that only limited regions are available. Each availability zone has got their own ZRS cluster within it, which is autonomous. You cannot actually make it out what is it. It's actually the backbone network. They have established the cluster. So it ensures, like, you know, that the data will be replicated here and there across data center facilities, so that in case of the data center, one of the data center where you deploy the storage, and that storage uses something called ZRS, that storage will be replicated to the parallel data center facility in the same region. So the only problem with the ZRS is it is not available for all regions. Take an example of in India, we got three geographical regions, Central India, South India, and West India. None of the region so far has actually been offering multiple parallel data center facility. So that means none of the region of India can actually offer you ZRS. However, if you actually look for something here in this context, I hope I told you last time also, when you see Azure regions, and those regions which have been coming here, you can see those regions which have been coming with the diamond inside, they are the one who actually been the regions which are actually blessed with the zones. So not every region which is that, you know, circle will not be blessed with the zone. So we have West US 2, East US, East US 2, we have North Europe, you know, we have Western Europe, something like that. Even if you have something somewhere here, Southeast Asia, which actually include, you know, somewhere, I think, if I'm not wrong, it is actually part of Singapore. So all these things you have to take care of. So ZRS is not actually been a good solution in case if you want, you know, that the three copies to be maintained across different data center facility, and the region which you operate actually is not offering the ZRS, means it doesn't offer, you know, availability zones. So in such a case, you know, you should not go for ZRS. Rather, you should either go for LRS, or you should actually go for or move or promote yourself to geo redundancy. In the geo redundancy service, rather than a local or zone which maintains three copies, geo redundant and read access geo redundant maintains six copies, three copy in every region. So here the data is replicated, three copy in the primary region, and 3 copies in the secondary region, which can be hundreds of miles away from the primary region. And data will be replicated using backbone network, but there will be a latency. So you can actually expect the latency. That's why if you are actually using some data which you want, like, you know, that in case if something goes wrong with the storage, you know, we should not actually have some data lagging, you know, when we are moving from one particular storage to other storage, you know, as a result of failover. So in that case, geo redundant is not good. So geo redundant may give you good reliability, you know, or good durability rather, you know, but there'll be a chances of lagging. So GRS, replicate your data to another data center in the secondary region, but the data is available to be read only after or during a failure. RAGRS, in that case, what it does is, it gives you from primary copy, it gives you one copy to be using as read and write. And from the secondary copy, 3 copies, it makes you of one copy to be read. So this way you can actually increase something called the optimization on for read over read and write. So RAGRS gives you better read in comparison to GRS. And definitely if you go any one way, take an example, I told you something, I don't know whether I've told you about it or not, but there's something called Azure Price Calculator. If you go to Azure Price Calculator and if you select pricing calculator here, and if you select technical storage account, let it be, and it'll fall back to, come towards downward here somewhere. Let me actually delete this one. I don't need the database to be calculated. I calculated for one client. Now let me actually see if I can. I think it is taking longer than expected. So let me again refresh it. And let me click on to storage account and click on to view. You can see here. So the moment if I go from LRS to RAGRS, you can see the price which has actually been coming from LRS. Let's say if I go just select LRS, the price allocation price which is coming, only allocation price, which is 1000 GB, it is coming as $20, including the read operation per 100,000 read and 100,000 write, read and write, the cost was coming as only 50 cents, which is pretty nominal compared to the storage which you use on premises. So the best part of it is this storage is actually right now we are using as hot storage and standard. The moment I use premium, just see that $20 which has been coming here for LRS, immediately it increases because premium means SSD. So you can see almost 7 times increased. How does you have to actually ask the storage guy. Storage guys can actually tell you that how many ops it happens in a particular application, depending upon what kind of application you are using. Take an example, here, what you'll be doing in the storage, you'll be actually putting your own disk, which will be a virtual disk, or it could be a kind of files and folder which you want to share among multiple VMs using file share or SMB share, which I told you. That based upon that, the storage guy who's been actually very good with the storage aspect, he might have actually noticed that what all number of IOPS which happens locally in the local storage. I think Desing Raja will be able to tell you that much. So storage guys who've been actually having a good experience towards storage, I've never been good in storage. That's the negative point of mine, I would say. So everyone cannot be good in every aspect, but I can say that there's no thumb rule. One, second, people take it the experience of the storage guy to actually determine that for a X kind of application in your organization, what kind of IOPS will be happening on peak hours or off peak hours. So they take an upper capping. That's how it happens, Kevin. So you have to take a rough estimate and you have to actually speak to the storage guys for this. Did I make it clear? Did I solve your query, or you still have some questions? Yeah, see, it's actually basic. I'll tell you what. I hope you've been actually following something called ITL process. Okay. So when you are actually taking an example of any particular client, you've been actually supporting some different type of industry. You know, maybe telecom industry, maybe banking industry, maybe insurance industry, maybe XYZ type of client. So definitely, as an ITL process, every organization follows something called service portfolio. So they might have actually taken the different kind of application which has been used by similar type of industries. So you have to take the help of those guys, those who have been actually handling similar kind of projects, and you know, that organization has handled those kind of projects earlier also for a different client, which could be a competitor. Take an example, I was actually been supporting something called banking client. So in the banking client, like, you know, that because Cognizant used to support bank client, a lot of bank client. I used to support UBS, which is one of the single, you know, one of the Swiss bank. So when I actually started supporting different other banks, so my portfolio was added in a way that, you know, I've been actually into more into banking domain. So a person who actually been good into those kind of domain, they will actually have that kind of, they carry them domain level expertise. So if a person is not having a domain level expertise, then definitely it is actually difficult to gauge that how many IOPS need to be taken care of. Okay, thank you very much, Kevin. Thanks wonderfully. I hope if I made it clear to you. And for more information, I would request you to actually speak to your colleague, which will be, I think, Mr. Desin Raja is here or not. He's from storage. Today, I think he's not joined. Raja, are you there? It seems he's not there. He was only interested in the storage part. And today only we are talking about the storage. Okay, thanks, dear. Thank you to Kevin. So my point is, like, you know, that billing part, again, well, you also have to understand here that the billing part is also dependent upon that what kind of license you have procured from Microsoft, because this is actually the pay-as-you-go licensing model. But if you actually have procured enterprise licensing, definitely the cost will be varying. I hope you might have actually understood, like, now the time when you were taking a student pass and you were provisioning any VM, your cost was varying than my cost, because I was using something called MSDN subscription and my cost was cheaper than your cost. So please understand that way also car pricing varies. So do not completely rely upon, like, you know, the pricing, whatever has been given here in the price calculator, because this pricing is pay as you go model of subscription, which is actually meant for individual users, not for the enterprise organization, because they may take, like, you know, the different pricing model from Microsoft. I think Microsoft actually give the discount to them also. Anyhow, coming back to the slide. So if you compare, like, you know, this is actually the metric which actually will make the sense for here, that if you look for the node availability within the data center, LRS, yes, because you know, three copies of the storage will be deployed into three different storage devices. So in case if one storage device fails also, you know, so node availability will also make your data available. In all four, it is available. Where in case if the whole data center goes on TOS, which is the rarest of rare situation, in that case, LRS will not be a feasible solution. So in that case, ZRS or GRS or RAGF for the matter may be of use. And if we look for, like, you know, that, okay, if a region-wise outage has happened because of, you know, some natural disaster in that particular geographical region, God forbid it happens to anyone. But if it happens, like, you know, in that case, LRS and ZRS within the same region will be of no use. In that case, you actually have to, you know, have a BCP site, a different geographical region site. Then, you know, if you wanted to have something called a read access of your data center from the remote site as well, in that case, RAGS will be happening, will be possible. And then it is telling you something about what all in that storage account will be available. This is actually general purpose version 1, version 2, blob. I hope you've been able to recall general purpose version 1 and version 2 used to offer you four type of service: file share, queue, table, and blob. whereas General Purpose 2 also shows you the same thing, but with the amendment in terms of the services which they offer. Along with that, General Purpose version 2 also offers you something called hot and cold backup. Hot and cold tier. Whereas General Purpose version 1 only gives you hot tier. Then we have something called General will only support standard and general purpose version 2. So that's how like it is actually. Standard means like version 1. Consider it as standard version 1. So somewhere whenever you find it as like version 1, it is similar to standard. Standard means like that it offers you all four types of service here. So here BLOB is not there in the LRS. So this particular slide is very important from the examination perspective. You know, remember that so that you can actually remember all the replication options which are available. Now the lesson 2, I hope this is what we have already discussed. And if I wanted to show you something, just give me a second. I just wanted to show you something in this context also so that one should not get confused what I'm talking about. Let me show you something. Let me take you to I hope my terminal is visible to everyone. I'm just going to PowerShell and I'm connected to, let me actually change the, because the font I could not change the, because I am not good in color scheme. So I thought of taking as a professional one. So let me actually go to PowerShell here and connect, because I don't want to open the Windows machine necessarily for only showing you the storage replication. Even though we have been to all these replications, but I still wanted to show you if you missed out. And it'll ask you to select this URL, put it into your browser. That's what I'm doing. And now it is asking me to enter the code. There's a code. Then it asked me to enter my credential. I enter my credential. I logged in. And here I can see the login will happen. So here, if I just show you something called Get AZ Storage Account under resource group, let's say RG1. Am I having any resource group under RG1? There's nothing. I don't have an RG2 also resource group. It says like the RG2 as a resource group has not been found. So what I'll do quickly is I'll create a new resource group, AZ resource group, name RG2 and location East US. What did I do? Oh, sorry, my bad. I gave it as RG2. So now once I took it here, then I'm creating a storage. Let me create a storage. You can recall like I'm creating a storage. Storage one. I just want to show you the difference between RGRS and GRS. And one more is, let me take an LRS. New AZ storage account. And I'll just give a name to it. Amit, I said dev1-location-east-us-resource-group name RG2-kind is storage version 2. Version 2 means like in the general purpose version 2. Then access tier. Access tier hot. Then I need to give kind. No, kind is already given. SKU. In this SKU, I will take standard, but if I press a tab, it will show me standard will give me GRS, LRS, RAGRS, and ZRS. So if I create first LRS, I think I am good to go. Nothing great. Yeah, it should be able to create. And this will be going to put it into storage one here. Okay. So it will be kept into storage one variable. Why I just wanted to keep into storage one variable in the PowerShell to show you that if I just go to $storage one and enter, and if I just say pipesign, I hope those who've been working on PowerShell a bit, they know if I wanted to print, they're not in a tabular manner, but in the format list manner. So it'll show me a full information about the storage. The storage has been deployed in the resource group RG2. The storage name is Amit S. Dev 1. And here SKU is basically, this is the SKU, it's been defined. And here access tier is hot. And most important thing, you actually have to see that it was provisioned under the primary location as East US. And because it was deployed in the East US, so it gives me primary endpoint. So if I just go to $storage one dot primary endpoint. Enter. So it'll show me like another blob, queue, table, file, web, and DFS, all these endpoints. This is an LRS. If I just create a similar thing, but this time I will create one, I will create Amit Asset Dev 2. I'll keep it into a variable called storage 2. And create the storage account as a unique name. And then I will use the SKU here as standard GRS. Enter. So while it is getting created, just look here that here when you look for that, this particular storage has got a primary location, but it doesn't have the secondary location because, you know, there's no secondary region where the storage has been provisioned because we selected like the storage as LRS at the time of creating it first. If you can recall, we use something called LRS locally, redundant copies, three copies, but this time we are creating storage 2. If I just go to storage 2 to print it in a formatted list, pipesign FL, and look here somewhere here, you can see that it shows you that you got East US as a primary location and you still have secondary location, but the secondary endpoint is not visible to you. Why? Because Microsoft maintains six copies, three here and three here, but it only gives the access of only one copy from the primary, not even the secondary. Secondary will be only made available in case if the primary location, you know, will fall, will you know, get into a disaster or something like that. But on the other hand, if you look for here, if you just see primary endpoint, here you got primary endpoint. Let me show you something called secondary endpoint. We don't have secondary endpoint. On the other hand, if I create another storage account, but this time I'll create as RAGRS. And I will create a third storage. Why I'm doing it from the PowerShell? Because I can only show it via PowerShell. Via UI or via portal, it is not possible to see the differences. If I create storage 3 as a variable, so you know, you'll get to know that storage 3 will not only have primary endpoint, but also will have secondary endpoint as well. So what does that mean? Secondary endpoint is only available for read-only purpose. So let's wait. Now, if I just look for storage 3, you can look somewhere here that we've got primary endpoint primary location, secondary endpoint, secondary location, and secondary endpoint is also shown here. Can you see? If I just type here, okay, storage tree dot primary endpoint, it is showing me. Let me show secondary endpoint. What happens is it actually creates another secondary endpoint only for reading purpose. Just see. For blob, you can read. For file queue, you can read. For table, you can read, but not for file. Why not for file? Because right now they are not giving the reading while you know somebody is actually writing onto the SMB share. I hope you've been aware of like, you know, that we had something called file share, which uses SMB Samba protocol to share the content from your storage to any particular device. So Samba share does not give you a kind of capability of reading and writing at both ends. So that means like, you know, that only read and write end will be given to you as a primary endpoint for Samba. The secondary endpoint for file share has not been given. So that's the reason. Because of the file share type of protocol which we are using, its own limitation perspective, you know, this has been removed. So my point out here is like that RAGRS actually makes six copies similar to GRS, but the difference seems to be huge because in case of storage 3, we don't get a secondary endpoint. Okay, that means in the case of GRS, you don't get a secondary endpoint. But in case of RAGRS, you get a secondary endpoint with an exclusion of file share to be not exposed as a secondary endpoint access point. So from these endpoints, secondary endpoint, at least you can read. And you can see here, if my storage account name is Amit Asset Dev Z3, so the secondary point will be automatically taken as Amit Asset Dev 3-secondary. Now, any application who will be actually writing, you know, the data, for uploading the data, downloading the data, updating the data, manipulating the data, we will give them the primary endpoint to the developer. And we'll also give the developer the secondary endpoint for only reading the data. And we have to explicitly tell them that, no, that this is a secondary endpoint. And if they're the Azure developer, they know what we are talking about in context to secondary endpoint. So they'll come across, okay, it's a secondary endpoint. That means we can only read the data from here, we cannot manipulate the data from these endpoints. So that's how the endpoints have been manipulated, guys. So I hope you understood the difference. Even though we discussed all these things at the time of storage also, but I just want to show you the difference between GRS and RAGRS specifically. So here you can see the secondary location has been automatically opted. You can look here. Secondary endpoint is automatically opted for East US. Did I define like, you know, okay, what is the secondary endpoint for the East US? The secondary endpoint was automatically taken by Microsoft. But along with that, in the case of storage 2, also that means I mean to say that GRS, it actually took East US and its respective secondary location, but it didn't give me secondary endpoint here. That means the choice of opting the secondary location for replication will be totally done by Microsoft. We don't have control onto it. At the time when you create RAGRS or GRS, you will never be asked to actually specify the secondary location where you want to keep a replica of copy. Microsoft choose the best location which can be optimal for replicating the data from your primary site to the respective secondary site. So then comes folders and file backup. We have been given a tool called, you know, Azure Backup. Okay. To my utter surprise, I would say, like, you know, that I do not opt this option for many of the client because there are reasons to it. And this is not a good tool because every tool cannot be good in cloud from a particular vendor. So yes, there are some, you know, backup tools which are available with Microsoft being a cloud vendor, also offered from third party. So I would rather go for those kind of backup solution than Microsoft backup, because Microsoft has never been good in backup. So Azure Backup, also known as a kind of enhanced version of NT Backup. Any hope? Anybody who's from the backup team? Is there anyone who can actually have been managing backup? Am I audible? Okay, you're not from the backup team, but you have used recovery service vault. Okay, but please understand, like, you know, that what exactly happens in case of backup is Microsoft also used to give a backup solution. Microsoft gives a backup solution as NT backup, one of the worst tool. And then Microsoft gave actually as a part of System Center family of the product. System Center family of product of Microsoft, which include SCCM, they are very good product. SCCM is a good product. SCOM, in fact, is also a good product. SCVMM is also a good product. Okay, and in fact, Microsoft rest of the System Center products are also good for configuration, for operation management, for virtual machine management. But when it comes to one of the product called System Center called SCDPM, Data Protection Manager, it is one of the worst tools. Anybody who's ever worked upon SCDPM, they will actually see the potential of the SCDPM, and they say, like, oh, this tool is so heavy and it actually is too demanding, resource demanding, that people only for backup, this tool is not good. I've got tools like, you know, that Acronis, I've got tools like Commvault, you know, I can get a tool like Tivoli. You know, they'll be better backup solution than, you know, Microsoft backup solution. And that's why, like, you know, that just for the training purpose, I'm actually talking about Azure Backup. So, you know, for the matter, any cloud, you know, be it AWS also. AWS gives you something called Glacier. You know, taking backup has not been challenging. You can actually take the cheapest media to take a backup into the cloud. Problem comes is when you recover the data will be, to recover the data for the security perspective will be saved to the backup location, you know, in a compressed as well as encrypted manner. So to pull the data, you know, you have to first actually pull the whole sort of lot, you know, maybe like, you know, that you wanted to pull only two or three files to be recovered. So you actually have to pull the whole data under which, you know, those two, three files were bundled together. So if those two, three files which are bundled together was bundled within a package of thousands of files, so that thousands of files was bundled together and compressed together and then encrypted together, that encrypted data need to be pulled from the cloud. So the moment you take the data out, you know, you will be charged heavily. That's the reason, like, you know, that in cloud backup is not, if the backup is not actually offer fine grain recovery, that means only those file which you want to recover, only those file can be pulled out. So if your backup solution is actually giving you that kind of you know, a fine grain level of recovery options, then only the backup solution is good. So in that context, I would say, you know, the solution like Commvault is one of the best. That's what I recommend to many of my clients. So Azure Backup, let's say, talk about the Azure Backup here. So Azure actually been offering, like, you know, their own services for backup and for restoring the data within the cloud. Okay, what Microsoft does in this case is, like, you know, they actually maintain the automatic storage management in the backup context. So we'll see exactly what does that mean. They actually offer you a different way of storing options within the backup. And they also offer you unlimited data transfer. But the data pulling and pulling always will be charged because network charge will be applied. Okay, unlimited means, like, now that you will not be restricted to pull the data out. But that doesn't mean that you will not be charged. Azure Backup will be secure because the data will be encrypted. So take an example, if your files are few KB only, you know, during encryption, those files will become into MBs and then will be going to get uploaded. So uploading is not a problem. Problem is, like, you know, from those particular files, if you want to download it, so you have to download the whole MB. So basically, even if your files are in KB size, you know, you are actually pulling out the whole lot. So Microsoft also offers you long-term retention and all those stuff. That's the benefit of backup. So to actually enable the backup, Microsoft offers you something called backing up of Azure level resources and on-premises resources. To do this, you know, first you have to go to portal and you have an option called Recovery Service Vault. So Recovery Service Vault. So, you know, this is a training which I've already done earlier. You know, I think if I can show you, like, you know, this particular thing has been created since long because I cannot delete it. You know, it takes time to get deleted right now. The reason being, like, you know, that this training happened, like, you know, 2 weeks before, and I had to show this particular vault. And because I did a critical backup and then restore, as a result, like, you know, that I cannot delete it. I still have to wait for few more days to actually get it deleted from my Azure subscription. But anyhow, I'll create one more. Because here I've taken the, I can show you something called backup item. If I show you, like, you know, I've taken the backup of a virtual machine. And I, even though that virtual machine has been deleted, it says, like, you know, that 11 days, this particular file was deleted, you know, 11 days earlier. And it required 2 more days to actually, you know, remove it completely from the Azure. This is called long-term retention. So Microsoft say, like, you know, that even if you try deleting the recovery service vault, you know, so the item which has been backed up of Azure, you know, will be retained for almost 14 days. So even if you try deleting it, Microsoft will maintain a copy of it and will only delete it after 14 days. So till that time, like, you know, this vault will be always there. So I have to just go and create a vault, and I'm going to create a vault under RG1 only. Let's say I'm creating a vault, and I'm just specifying here my recovery service vault. And I'm going to create here under East US. Nothing. Next is tagging only. So I'll just say review and create. So this is actually, vault is actually a store where you want to keep the backups and all those stuff. So we'll let that vault to be created. So when you create a vault, and when the vault is in, you know, once it will be created, then we can actually have an option of, you know, taking the backup of two things. Either the workload from Azure workload could be, you can take the Azure, what kind of information you can backup of Azure. You can backup of virtual machines. Virtual machine can be backed up. What in the virtual machine will be backed up will be the VHD data of the virtual machine. You can backup the database, you know, if you have a database like SQL Server, you know, you can backup that. You can also backup, like, you know, that in your storage account. Rather than taking a storage account backup, there's no point of taking the storage account backup. Let me tell you why. Because storage account by default is making, like, you know, multiple replica. But what you can do is, within the storage account, you got something called file share. So within file share, you actually have deployed some critical files, you know, in the file share. You can take those individual file level backup, rather than actually having the replica of storage account for the residency purpose. What we are trying to do is here, for recovery purpose, we actually can take the backup of the file share data. So that is in context to Azure. For on-premises, you actually can take the backup of hypervisors machines. If you have on-premises hypervisors, that means in your organization you have hypervisors or virtual machines, you know, VMware virtual machines, or on-premises SQL Server, on-premises SharePoint Server, on-premises Exchange Server, you know, bare metal servers also can be backed up. But since I'm not having any one of these, so I will only choose this option of files and folder. So I will create one particular, I have to open that virtual machine. Let me open that virtual machine, VMware. And I will run the local VM. Let that VM to be run. Meanwhile, I can actually see the recovery service vault. So if I just go to recovery service vault, and if I'll just go to my recovery service vault, here what I can do is I can take the backup. So if I just go back to one is I can click onto this also, or is that under getting started, I can click onto backup. And here it says, like, you know, what type of load workload you can backup. Azure Stack is basically on-premises Azure Cloud. On-premises Azure Cloud. This is actually private cloud of yours. So I'm going to take a session for Azure Stack for SCL soon. I've taken it twice for only SCL. So there, some companies actually maintain, like, you know, something called hybrid environment. So they wanted to have a same UI for on-premises cloud. Earlier, Azure, Microsoft used to give on-premises cloud using SCCM. So now Microsoft actually has designed one product called Azure Stack, which is actually for on-premises cloud. So you can take the backup of on-premises cloud. You can take on-premises individual machines like hypervisor virtual machines, VMware virtual machines, SQL Server, SharePoint Server, Exchange Server, all these things. We can also take the backup of files and folder in the on-premises. In the Azure workload, if you have a virtual machine, you can take the backup of virtual machine. You can take the backup of SQL Server, Azure File Share. This has actually been added into 2 weeks back. 2 weeks back. 2 weeks back. You know, SAP HANA. If you have a SAP HANA database, you can take the backup of that. But SAP HANA itself is actually very, very big database because it's an in-memory database. Taking the backup will be actually one. It will actually require too much storage, and second, you know, you'll be charged accordingly. But only if you have a SAP HANA data. So you can actually take the backup of that. So as per your demo, which has been shown, like, you know, that I create a recovery service vault, I will configure the recovery service vault, and I'll be going to take a backup of on-premises folder level backup. So I'm going to do that. So this is my VM, which is running here. This is my local virtual machine, guys. This is my Windows machine running under VMware. I hope I gave correct password. Suddenly running slow. Why? Yep. This machine. So this is a local machine which is running in my VMware workstation or VMware Fusion, which is actually a Windows version of Mac version of VMware. So what I do out here is I've already created a recovery service vault. Now, in order to take the backup, I just have to open my portal and I'll say, oh, I want to take a backup on-premises. It says, what level backup? I said, file and folder backup. It says, to do this, you have to prepare the infrastructure. I said, what you have to do? The first step is you have to download one agent. We call it as recovery service agent. So I'll say, okay, download the agent. This will be an agent which need to be downloaded onto that machine whose backup you want to take. So this Mars agent comes out to be 40 MB approximately. So let me take that backup, the download of that Mars agent. Mars agent, also known as, it's a short form, but, it's an acronym. It stands for Microsoft Azure Recovery Service Agent, MARS. Microsoft Azure Recovery Service Agent. So I'm done just downloading the MARS installer so that I can install it. If I go back to the downloads folder, select the MARS installer, copy it, and just put it here. Paste. So this is a Mars agent, and if I just double click onto the Mars agent, next. It is asking me to install the prerequisites. So it may install some prerequisite for Mars agent, which will be Visual C++. So let it be. It automatically will do it. So sometimes it takes time, so we have to wait. So what actually has been happening here? Let me tell you this. Let me tell you this exactly. It looks like if I just go to Google Drive, Let me see if the diagram has been created here. All the way, I have to draw that. Oh, nothing. Thank you. So, take an example, like, you know, that I've got something called on-premise infrastructure here. In the on-premise infrastructure, I may have hypervisor as VMware or hypervisor where I'm running the VM, or may have SQL Server, or may have something called, you know, my on-premises, on-prem files and folders, or may have, like, you know, Exchange Server. Or may have SharePoint Server. Or this will be a hypervisor. Hypervisor or, you know, hypervisor based VM backup. So any kind of backup I can actually take. What I need to do is in the on-premises, you know, the respective end which I want to take a backup of, I need to install a Mars agent there. So right now, because I don't have anything except a local machine which can have on-premises files and folders, so I'll install this Mars agent here. So what I'll do is I'm actually installing Mars agent here. So it'll ask me, okay, in this machine, it will be installed here. No problem. I will install it. Next. I don't want to do an update, because I only need it for today. Usually you actually enable the update. That's a recommended practice from Microsoft end. It has got some prerequisite software, which is like, you know, that because this machine already has got Visual Studio installed. As a result of Visual Studio .NET, I've got .NET framework installed and PowerShell installed. So nothing to be worried about. So behind the scene, Mars agent will be using these tools. If it is not installed, then, you know, your machine may ask, you may be asked to actually install those tools. So let that thing will be working here. Installation will proceed. After the installation complete, it will show me something called proceed to registration here. Here I'll get a button called proceed to registration. So let that agent will be completed. Come on. Sometimes it runs too slow. Come on. So right now what I'm doing is I'm actually installing Mars agent onto my on-premises, one of the machine which has got file folder backup to be taken. to the vault. This is my vault, actually the Azure I'm actually using on vault. So this March agent will be actually pushing the backup here. So during pushing the backup, what will happen, like, you know, that backup will be encrypted and compressed while being sent over the wire for security purpose, so that even the backup data can also be not can be accessed by any unauthorized personnel. So to ensure that prior being sent over the wire. Over the network. Sorry. So let's wait. I think it is done. And it shows you proceed to registration. I just have to go to proceed to registration. So what will happen, like, now the Mars agent will ask me, okay, please select the vault credential, download it from the quick start page in the Microsoft Azure backup vault. I didn't do it. So I have to go all the way to my portal. The first step I've already done. The second step says download the vault credential. And I say, like, you know, I've already installed the agent. So check this. Then only this button will be enabled. I just download. This will be giving me one small, simple file, vault credential file. This file I actually copy and paste it here. And then I will give that credential here. Browse, and I will select that file under desktop. This was the file, my record resolve vault, and today only it has been created right now. Please understand, this file plays a major role, and what will happen, this file will be securely making a connection in between this particular agent which is installed locally here and this recovery service vault running in the East US region. So doing this, it says backups are encrypted to protect the confidentiality of their data. Generate a type phrase to encrypt and decrypt the backup from the service. And in case if this machine whose backup has been taken, you know, will get failed on the on-premises. So if you want to restore the backup of this machine to some other machine, you would require that passphrase. So, you know, keep that passphrase, whatever we said, generate. Either you can generate or you can give your own passphrase. Maximum can be only 36 characters, and I'm just saving it under desktop. It by default will create that particular file for me. Let me show it to you. And it says you have selected a location on the machine to store the passphrase, exporting the passphrase to the source machine. Okay, what it can do is it can corruption or compromisation may happen. So do you want to continue? Because I don't have any other machine. So you can see, as a result of registration, you know, what will I get is I will get a connectivity in between this particular machine, this machine which is running, and my vault which is running in my portal, which is this vault, which is my recovery service vault. So let's wait for that registration to complete.
Thanks for watching. To watch our complete session, enroll for our premium membership. Click onto the join button and enroll yourself with the best suited option.
Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries. We will reply to them at the earliest. Want to study further? Subscribe to our paid membership to get a deep dive into each and every topic. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to our DevOps School channel and hit the bell icon to learn more. Keep learning.